Hi guys, this is Keith from BBC Learning English, and today I'm going to tell you about some informal ways of using English. Now, in English, when we have scheduled formal meetings, we can say we have an appointment. So for example, I can say, I have an appointment with my doctor, or I have an appointment with my lawyer. But you never ever say, I have an appointment with my friends. That's too formal. Now, to talk about appointments with friends, we simply say, I'm meeting my friends this weekend. So it's meet someone, not have an appointment. Remember, meet someone. And I'll meet you next week. Hi guys, this is Keith from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you how to use for and since. We use for to describe how long an activity or a situation lasts. For example, I can say, I go running every day for 10 minutes. That's not true though. On the other hand, since is used to describe when an activity or a situation began. For example, I can say, I have been recording this video since 10 o'clock. So remember, for is used to describe how long an activity or a situation lasts, whereas since is used to describe when an activity or a situation began. It's easy, isn't it?
Hello everyone, I'm Sam from BBC Learning English, and today we are going to look at the difference between so and such. To make an adjective stronger, we use so. For example, Michael is so nice. We use such when we want to make an adjective plus a noun stronger. For example, Michael is such a nice person. For this reason, it's not correct to say Michael is so nice person, because we have the adjective nice and the noun person together. It's so simple, right?
Hi, I'm Phil from BBC Learning English. Today I'm going to tell you how to use the words fun and funny. They're both words we use to talk about happy things, but they don't mean the same thing. So we use fun to talk about things we enjoy. So I think going out with friends is fun, watching football is fun, practicing English is fun. It is, isn't it? Now the main use of funny is something that makes you laugh. Jokes make you laugh, comedy films make you laugh, people make you laugh. So if it makes you happy, it's fun, and if it makes you laugh, it's funny. Now add a comment, tell us what you think is fun and what you think is funny.
Hi guys, this is Keith from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you about some informal ways of using English. In English, when we want to tell a friend about something, we don't use the word notify. That's what businesses do. Businesses notify their customers, and the Prime Minister might notify her ministers, but we don't notify our friends about our weekend plans. It's too formal. In English, we say, I'm going to let my friend know that I'm going out. Let him know. Not notify, let him know. Now you know.
Welcome to BBC Learning English. I'm Sam, and today we are going to look at both, either, and neither together. In all three cases, we are talking about two things. In this case, let's talk about tea and coffee. We use both to talk about two out of two things. For example, both tea and coffee contain caffeine. We use neither to talk about zero out of two things. Neither tea nor coffee contains alcohol. And we use either to talk about one out of two things. For example, in the morning I drink either tea or coffee. Not both, just one. Which do you drink in the morning? Either coffee, or tea, or both, or neither?
Hi, I'm Dan from BBC Learning English, and today I'm going to tell you the difference between those two confusing words, history and story. Both words are used for a description of events, so that makes them the same, right? Wrong, they are not the same. History is the description or study of past events based on fact. often to understand their consequences. Christopher Columbus arrived in America in 1492. A story is a description of a series of real or imagined events, often to entertain people. After arriving in America in 1492, Columbus and his crew were attacked by a giant man-eating T-Rex dinosaur. That didn't really happen, it's just a story. So, history is a description of past events based on fact, and stories are descriptions of real or imagined events, often to entertain. Leave us a comment about a piece of history or an imagined story from your culture, and we'll try and guess which is which.
Hi, I'm Sian from BBC Learning English. What's the difference between stop to do and stop doing something? Well, stop what you're doing right now, because that's what I'm going to tell you. When we use stop plus ing, the activity in the ing form stops. So, I have stopped drinking coffee. I'm not drinking coffee anymore, I'm only drinking water. But when stop is followed by the infinitive, it means we stop doing another action to do the action in the infinitive. So I stopped to buy a tea this morning. I stopped walking in order to buy a tea. Right, I'm gonna stop talking now. Write me a comment and tell me something that you've stopped doing.
Hi, this is Keith from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you the differences between must and have to. Both must and have to talk about obligations. However, now, we use have to when we talk about obligations others decide for us. It's a law or a rule, so it cannot be changed. For example, at BBC, we have to show our passes to enter the building. This is a rule decided by the BBC. On the other hand, we use must when we talk about obligations we decide for ourselves or others. For example, my boss might say to me, "You must be more organized." Or I might say to myself, "I must exercise more often."
Hi, I'm Phil from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you how to use to and very. They're both intensifiers, but they don't mean the same thing. We use very to make an adjective or an adverb stronger. So we could say, the building is very old. That could be a good thing. It's beautiful. Or it could be a bad thing. It's falling down. Or it might not matter. If we use to with two O's, then it means it's a problem. We could say, it's too easy. It means it's a waste of time. It's a problem. It's not too difficult. In fact, it's very easy. Just remember that if we use to, it's a problem.
Hi, I'm Dan from BBC Learning English, and today I'm going to talk to you about person and persons, people and peoples. A person is a human, man, woman, or child. It is a singular countable noun. There was one person at the door. The plural of person is people. It refers to a group or a number of human beings. It is a plural, countable noun. There were three people at the door. So how about persons? Persons is a plural countable noun. It's similar to people, but it's considered more polite and more formal. It's most often seen written down. This lift can hold a maximum of 15 persons. And peoples? Peoples is the countable plural form of people and comes from the other meaning of people. People can mean nation. The Aztecs were a people that lived in the Americas. Or there are many peoples living on the earth. They are all human, so far.
Hi guys, this is Keith from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you the differences between mustn't and don't have to. Now, must and have to are similar in meaning. They are both used to describe obligations. However, their negative forms are completely different in meaning. We still use mustn't to talk about obligations. For example, in the house, I mustn't wear shoes, you know, to keep the house clean. But don't have to does not describe obligations, so the choice is yours. For example, if your teacher said you don't have to do your homework, well, then choice is yours. You can say, all right, I won't.
Welcome back to BBC Learning English. I'm Sam, and today we're looking at the difference between come back and go back. They both mean to return, but we use them differently. We use come back when we return here. So for example, I'm in the BBC building now. Tonight I will go home, and tomorrow I will come back here. Like a full circle. We use go back to mean that we return there. For example, I am at work now and tonight I will go back home. I am not at home now, but tonight I will go back. Half the circle. So please come back to BBC Learning English for more videos.
Hi, I'm Sian from BBC Learning English, and today we're going to look at the difference between raise and rise. So raise and rise both refer to something going up, but there's a difference in how we use them. Raise always needs a direct object. So if you raise something, you move it up. For example, I raise my eyebrows when I'm surprised. And it doesn't have to be literal, so the government planned to raise taxes. Don't forget, this is a regular verb, so the past and past participle are both raised. But with rise, there's no direct object. So if something rises, it goes up or increases by itself. The sun rises at 6 a.m. at the moment. Careful, this is an irregular verb, so the past is rose and the past participle is risen.
Hi everybody, Tom here from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to explain the difference between to steal and to rob. Both to steal and to rob mean to take something without permission. To steal focuses on the object or the thing which is taken. For example, hey, somebody just stole my phone. Rob focuses on the victim of the crime. For example, the men robbed a bank last night. I wouldn't say someone robbed my phone. I would say they robbed me and stole my phone.
Welcome to BBC Learning English. I'm Sam, and today we are looking at the difference between every time and all the time. We use all the time to talk about something that always or usually happens. For example, many people think that in the UK it rains all the time. And yes, it does rain a lot. We use every time when we are talking about each individual time something happens. For example, every time I go to the beach, it rains. We don't know how often I go to the beach, but each individual time I go, it rains. There, we hope you learn something every time you watch one of these videos.
Hi, I'm Phil from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you how we use play, do, and go with different sports. So for team sports or ball games, we use play. So I can say, I play football, I don't play tennis. For more individual activities, we use do. So we can say, I do exercise, I don't do judo. Then for activities ending in ing, we often use go. So I can say, I go running, or I don't go swimming. Of course, there are some exceptions, but try to remember. Play for team sports or ball games, do for individual activities, and go for activities ending in ing.
Hi, I'm Sam from BBC Learning English, and today we are looking at the difference between no, not any, and none. Let's have a look. Imagine you ask me this question.
Do you have any change?
I have zero change, and I can say this in three different ways. Sorry, I have no change, where we use the verb have with no, followed by a noun. Sorry, I don't have any change, where we use the negative don't, followed by the verb, followed by any, followed by the noun. Or I can say, sorry, none at all, where we use none without a verb or a noun, so it's a short answer. So now you shouldn't have any problems with this.
Hi everybody, I'm Tom from BBC Learning English. People often confuse the words specially and especially. Today, I'm going to tell you the difference. Both of these words are adverbs. Especially means in particular or most of all. For example, I like food, but I especially like sandwiches. This means that I particularly like sandwiches. They're my favourite kind of food. Specially, however, has a different meaning. Specially means for a particular purpose or in a particular way. So, this sandwich was specially made. Dan made a special sandwich just for me. Thank you, Dan.
Hi, this is Keith from BBC Learning English, and today I'm going to tell you the differences between be going to and the present continuous to talk about future plans. We use be going to talk about future plans. The plan will probably take place, but it's not a definite plan. If I say I'm going to meet my friends this weekend, it means I made plans with my friends. But it could mean that we haven't decided where to meet, nor have we decided what time to meet. On the other hand, we use the present continuous to talk about future plans that are almost definite. If I say I'm meeting my friends this weekend, it means I made plans with my friends, and we may have decided where to meet and what time to meet. So this plan is almost definite and it's difficult to cancel. So remember, the present continuous describes a more definite plan than be going to.
Hi, I'm Phil from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you the difference between even though and even if. Now, we use them both for emphasis, but they don't mean the same. We use even though to introduce something that's true, but might be a little bit unexpected. It's a bit like despite. Even though I hate driving, I'm still going to Scotland by car. Even though I hate tennis, I'm still going to watch the final. We use even if to introduce something hypothetical, so it might not be real. Even if it's sunny when we're in Scotland, I'm not going swimming. Even if you paid me, I wouldn't watch that film. So, even though is for things that are true but unexpected. And even if is for things that are hypothetical, so they might not be real. Even though they look the same, they are different, even if you didn't notice at first.
Hi, Sian here for BBC Learning English, and today we're going to look at these two little words. So been and gone are both past participles, both used with the present perfect, but they don't have the same meaning. We use been to talk about complete visits. So she has been to Paris means that she visited Paris at some point in the past and now she's back in the UK. Careful with pronunciation. When we say been in a sentence, it becomes been. She's been to Paris. But she's gone to Paris means she travelled to Paris and she's still in Paris now. She's on holiday. She's gone to Paris. Easy, right? Been, you go somewhere and return. Gone, you go somewhere but don't return.
Welcome everyone, Sam from BBC Learning English here. You probably already know that in English we have some verbs that are always followed by the infinitive, for example, want, and other verbs that are always followed by the gerund, for example, enjoy. But we also have some verbs in English that can be followed by either the infinitive or the gerund, and the meaning will change. For example, remember. Remember to bring your umbrella, where first you remember and then you bring your umbrella. This is commonly used when talking about the future. I remember meeting my best friend when I was little, where first I met my best friend and then I remembered it. This is now a memory, so it's commonly used when talking about the past.
Hi guys, Dan for BBC Learning English here. This time we're looking at the difference between prevent and avoid. Prevent basically means stop. If you prevent something, you stop it from happening, often before it starts. You can prevent something from happening, or prevent someone from doing something. For example, the arrival of the police prevented crime. Or, losing my passport prevented me from flying. Or, I prevented her from slapping me. Wow! Now, avoid basically means miss. If you avoid something, you try to make it miss you. For example, I avoided meeting my ex. Or, I avoided the slap easily.
Hello again everyone, Tom here for BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to explain the difference between what and which in questions. What is used to ask a question which has a lot of possible answers. Consider the question, what do you want to eat for lunch? Here, there are no choices to limit your reply. You could choose anything you want. We use which when we have options to choose from. So here we have two choices, a sandwich and a melon. So I can say, which do you want to eat? The sandwich or the melon? Now, next time you need to ask a question, you'll know which word to use. What for anything and which when you have a choice.
Hi, this is Keith from BBC Learning English, and today I'm going to tell you the differences between while and during. We can use while and during to say that a shorter event happened within a longer event. They mean the same, but the grammar's different. After while, we have a clause. A clause is a group of words containing a subject and a verb. So we can say, while I was having lunch, my phone rang. Remember that the verb in the while clause is usually in an ing form. We can also use while with just an ing form. So we can say, while having lunch, my phone rang. So we remove the subject and the be verb. However, during is different because it can only be used with a noun phrase. So we can say, during lunch, my phone rang. We cannot use a clause or just the ing form. So, same meaning, but different grammar.
I'm Sian from BBC Learning English, and today we're going to look at the difference between lay and lie. So, lay always has an object, and it means put something or someone down carefully, normally in a flat position. When I eat, I lay a cloth on the table. You can lay a baby in a cot. The past tense is laid, but careful with the spelling. I laid all my cards on the table. The verb lie doesn't have an object, and it means that you are in a flat position, or you put yourself in a flat position. So you move on your own. Tonight, I want to lie on the sofa and watch a film. But be careful. Now, the past of lie is lay. Yesterday, I lay on the beach and read my book.
Hi, I'm Phil from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you the difference between affect with an A and effect with an E. Just remember that affect with an A is a verb. It means to influence. So for example, tiredness is affecting my work. Effect with an E is usually a noun and it means the result of something. The effect of not having breakfast is to feel really hungry. Effect can be a verb, it's very formal and it means to implement something. The management affected a new policy. So if you find this difference affecting your English, just remember that affect with an A is a verb and the effect with an E is usually a noun. And the effect will be you don't make any more mistakes.
Hi everyone, Dan for BBC Learning English here with a quick explanation of the difference between remember and remind. Now, both remember and remind are verbs of memory, but they are not the same. Remember is about having a memory and has two verb patterns. Number one, remember plus verb ing is used when you remember something from the past. For example, I remember saying, hi everyone.
Hi everyone, Dan.
See? Number two, remember plus full infinitive is used when something is to be done in the future. For example, I must remember to do my shopping later. However, remind means make someone remember. Its verb pattern is remind plus somebody plus a full infinitive verb. For example, you must remind me to do my shopping later. Something can also remind someone of something. For example, this cup reminds me of my other cup.
Hi everybody, I'm James and welcome back to this week's English in a Minute. This week we're going to look at the differences between actually and at the moment. These two phrases are often confused, so let's take a look at an example. At the moment, I'm making this program, but actually I should be in a meeting. So this sentence shows both phrases, but they're actually quite different. Let's break it down. At the moment, I'm making this program. As you can see, I'm making this program right now. So at the moment means now or in the present. But actually, I should be in a meeting. Now, in this part of my sentence, actually isn't talking about time at all. Actually means in fact or in reality. So if you want to talk about now, say at the moment. But if you want to say in reality, say actually. At the moment, I want to go and make a coffee, but actually, I think I'll go back to my desk. Bye.
Hi guys, this is Keith from BBC Learning English. And today, I'm going to tell you the differences between until and by. We use until to talk about doing something up to a certain point in time. If I say I have to take care of my dog until 5 p.m, it means I will start taking care of my dog now and stop taking care of it at 5 p.m. On the other hand, we use by to talk about doing something before a future time or a deadline. If I say I have to finish an essay by 5 p.m, it means I can start anytime, but I will make sure that at 5 p.m, I have finished writing the essay. So I may even finish it at 3 p.m. or anytime before 5. So we use until to describe doing something up to a certain point in time, and we use by to describe doing something before a future time or a deadline.
Hi everyone, Dan for BBC Learning English here. Today we're going to talk about don't mind and doesn't matter. The verb mind means dislike, be annoyed by, or object to. It's followed by verb ing and often used in negatives and questions. For example, do you mind opening the window?
No, I don't mind.
If someone says, I don't mind, it means that they have no preference or that they are happy for something to happen. However, the verb matter in English can mean be important. English matters means English is important. If we say it doesn't matter, it means that the thing that we are talking about is not important or not significant. Do you want tea or coffee?
It doesn't matter.
Okay, sometimes they can both mean the same thing.
Do you want chicken for dinner?
I don't mind.
Do you want chicken for dinner?
It doesn't matter to me.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Tom here for BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to explain the difference between everyone and anyone. When I say, hello everyone, I'm talking to all the people in a group or all the people watching this video. Anyone, however, relates to any one individual person in a group, and we often use it to ask questions. For example, is anyone listening or can anyone answer today's question? Here, I'm asking if any individuals in the group are listening. If the whole group is listening, we can say, yes, everyone is listening, which is something that English teachers love to hear.
Hi, I'm Phil from BBC Learning English. Today, I'm going to tell you the difference between still, already, and yet. They all talk about things around the present, but they don't mean the same. We use still to talk about something that hasn't finished. Are you still studying? Let's go out. We use already to talk about something that has finished and maybe we didn't think it would have by now. She's already finished work. She's gone home. We use yet in questions and negatives to talk about things that haven't happened, but we think they will. Haven't you left yet? You'll be late. So just remember, things that are still happening haven't finished. Things that have already happened have finished, and things that are yet to happen haven't started. Are you still watching? Have you learned this yet? You remember it already? Fantastic.
Welcome to BBC Learning English. I'm Sam, and today I'm happy. In fact, I'm very happy. I'm really happy. Thrilled. I'm really thrilled. I'm absolutely thrilled. My happiness keeps getting bigger and bigger. I started with the word happy. Happy is a gradable adjective, so I can be happy here, quite happy here, very or really happy here. What's another way to say very or really happy? Thrilled. Thrilled is not a gradable adjective. It's an extreme adjective. It's already up here. So can we make it stronger? Yes, you can use really, I'm really thrilled, or absolutely, I'm absolutely thrilled. But you can't use very.
Hi guys, Dan for BBC Learning English here. Today we're going to talk about the verbs wish and hope. Now, the verb wish can be used in many ways, and you can get much more detailed information on our website. However, we generally use wish to talk about a present or past situation that we want to change, but understand that it can't. Present wishes are wish plus a past simple verb. For example, I wish I were taller. Past wishes are wish plus past perfect. I wish I had grown taller. Hope can also be used in different ways, but generally, when we hope, we talk about something that we want or expect for the future. Hope can be followed by a full infinitive. For example, I hope to see you soon. But more commonly, we follow it with a present tense that has a future meaning, or with will. I hope you pass your driving test. I hope you'll have a good time.
Hi everyone, I'm Saskia, and in this episode, we're going to look at what it means when we add the word ever to the end of a question word. The most important thing to know is that when we add ever to a question word, it's not talking about anything specific. It often means we don't know the who or the where, or they are not important. Let's look at some examples. Whoever ate my cake is in big trouble. This example means that I do not know who ate my cake. Whenever I go to the cafe, there are never any sandwiches left. This means the time when I go to the cafe is not important. I never put on weight, so I can eat whatever I like. This means what I eat isn't important. The puppy followed the girl wherever she went. By adding ever to where, it means the place is not important. So if you want to say the time, place, person, or thing you're talking about is not important or unknown, just add ever to the correct question word.
Hi, I'm Tim from BBC Learning English, here to tell you about two words we use to say that things are similar. We use like as a preposition before a noun or pronoun, and it means similar to. He ran like the wind, not he ran as the wind. We use like and not as to compare appearances. This house looks like a castle. As can be used as a preposition. It means in the role of.
My best friend's name is Tim. He's very Tim.
Dan, as your friend, I have to say, you're not a good singer. We often use as to talk about people's jobs. I work as an actor. Be careful using like and as because the meaning can change. As your brother, I'll try to help you means I actually am your brother. Change it to like and it means I'm not your brother, but I want to act in a similar way.
Hi everyone, I'm James. We're going to look at the difference between in case and if in today's English in a minute. Look at these examples. I'll call you if I need help with my homework. I'll call you in case I need help with my homework. In the example with if, it means that I might call you in the future, but it depends if I need help or not. The second sentence with in case means I'm going to call you before I do my homework to prevent any problems. Let's take a look at another example. I'll take an umbrella in case it rains. I'll take an umbrella if it rains. Just like in our first example, in case means I'm going to take my umbrella anyway, to prevent any problems. But in the example with if, this means that you only take an umbrella because it is raining when you leave. So if you want to learn more English, join us on social media or on our website. In case you can't remember the link, here it is.
Hi, I'm Sam from BBC Learning English, and today we're going to look at the difference between less and fewer when comparing things. It's actually very simple. We use fewer with countable nouns and less with uncountable nouns, but even native speakers get this wrong. So let's have a look at some examples. I moved recently, and comparing my old area to my new neighbourhood, I can say, there are fewer restaurants and fewer cafes, and there is less traffic and less pollution. Cafes and restaurants are countable nouns. You can count them on your fingers and you can make them plural. So we use fewer. Pollution and traffic are uncountable nouns. You can't count them on your fingers and you can't make them plural. So we use less.
Welcome back to English in a Minute from BBC Learning English. I'm James, and today we're going to talk about the difference between in the end and at the end. We're going to go to the beach at the end of the month. In this example, we're talking about a specific moment in time, the final moment of the month. In the end, we decided not to go to the beach. Whereas at the end is about the final moments, in the end is about the time leading up to the final moments. Let me explain the example in more detail. Hey there, shall we go to the beach?
I'm not sure. I might be busy.
Did you two go to the beach?
No, in the end we couldn't go. Sam and I considered going to the beach, but eventually we decided not to go. If at the end of the video you don't quite understand, watch it again. In the end, you might just find it useful. Bye everyone.
I'm Sam from BBC Learning English, and this is me in class.
So, adverbs of frequency go after the main verb.
How am I feeling? Bored or boring? I was feeling bored because the lesson was boring. So the lesson was the reason I felt bored. So ed endings describe the feeling, and ing endings describe the reason you have that feeling. And this works for other adjectives too. So if the lesson is interesting, I feel interested. If something is tiring, I'm tired. If something is relaxing, I'm relaxed. If something is surprising, I'm surprised. If something is exciting, I'm excited. So, tell us how these videos make you feel.
Hi, I'm Phil, and I'm going to tell you the difference between go on doing and go on to do something. Now, the meaning of go on depends on whether it's followed by the gerund or the infinitive. So if we have go on doing, that's the gerund, it means to continue doing something. So for example, I'd like to go on talking now, or I really like this city, I'd like to go on living here for years. Go on to do, that's the infinitive, means to progress on to something. For example, I'd like to go on to study more languages, or you could go on to have an even better job. Just remember that if you go on doing something, you don't change, and if you go on to do something, you do change. So, if you go on practicing your English, you'll go on to be even better than you are now.
Hi everyone. What's the difference between maybe and may be? Well, we're going to find out in this English in a Minute. May is used to express possibility, usually not a very certain one. It's a modal verb, so it's always followed by a bare infinitive. The bare infinitive of be is be. Using the two together, we can make a sentence. Don't call her, she may be at work. Now, maybe is just one word. It's an adverb and it has a few uses. Most commonly, it means perhaps or possibly. In this case, it's often the first word in the sentence. Don't call her, maybe she's at work. However, put it in front of an amount to mean around or approximately. This video will be seen by, maybe a million people. Make it happen, people.
Hi, Saskia for BBC Learning English here, and today I'm going to tell you about how we use verbs of perception in English. There are a number of these verbs, but I'm just going to look at two with you now, see and hear. When we use these verbs, this is the form. First, the verb of perception. Then, the object of the sentence. Then we have either the infinitive without to or the ing form. Here's an example. I heard him go down the stairs. Or, I heard him going down the stairs. There's a slight difference between these two forms. When we use the infinitive, it suggests that we hear or see the whole action or event. Using the ing form suggests that we hear or see something in progress. I saw her cross the street means I saw her cross from one side to the other. I saw her crossing the street means I saw her in the middle, on the way across.
Hi, I'm Georgina from BBC Learning English. In today's lesson, we look at the difference between unless and as long as. Unless and as long as can be used to replace if in different situations. Let's have a look at some example sentences. I will go to the party if you come too. I will go to the party as long as you come too. Both of these sentences have the same meaning. Notice that the verb after if and as long as is positive. Now look at these sentences. If you don't do your homework, you can't watch the film. Unless you do your homework, you can't watch the film. Both of these sentences have the same meaning, but notice that the verb after if is negative and the verb after unless is positive. Bye!
Hello, I'm Sam, and we are going to look at the difference between good and well together. I make very good pizza. What is good describing? It's describing pizza, which is a noun, which makes good an adjective. And where does it go in the sentence? It goes before the noun. I make pizza very well. What is well describing here? It's describing make. And make is a verb, so well is an adverb. And where does it go in a sentence? It goes after the verb. Careful, because well can also be an adjective, but only to talk about feeling healthy or unhealthy. I wasn't feeling very well yesterday, but I'm fine today. So keep watching these videos so your English will be good and you will be able to speak it well.
Hi, I'm Phil, and I'm going to tell you the difference between little and a little. Yes, they almost mean the same thing. No, we don't use them in the same way. They both refer to small quantities and we use them with uncountable nouns. If we use little with no article, then it's usually negative. The small quantity is a problem. There's little money left, we can't buy anything. Or there's little time left, we need to start now. But if we use a little with the article, it's usually positive. It almost means at least we've got some. We've got a little money, let's spend it on a party. We've got a little time, let's have some tea. Remember it like this. If you've got a little money, but little time, you could pay someone to help you. But if you've got little money and a little time, you should do it yourself.
I'm Georgina from BBC Learning English. Have you ever thought about the difference between lend and borrow? They are both verbs, but they're used in different ways. Lend means to give something to someone, generally for a short time. For example, the bank lent me some money. If you want to say who you lent something to, you can use the preposition to. I lent my mobile phone to James. Oh no, I forgot my pen. Can you lend me a pen? Borrow means to ask someone for something. Oh no, I can't read this. Can I borrow your glasses? If you want to say who you borrowed something from, you can use the preposition from. For example, I borrowed a book from the library. Oh, I'm late. I need to borrow a laptop from Sam for my meeting. Got to go.
Hi, I'm Tim, and I'm going to tell you the difference between to and enough when we use them as adverbs. They refer to quantity, but there's an important difference. Enough is usually positive. It means that something is suitable or sufficient. Oh, great! This t-shirt's big enough. It'll fit me perfectly. It's colourful enough for my sister's party. To usually has a negative meaning. It's used to say that something is a problem or it's unsuitable in some way. Oh no, this is too short. I can't wear this. It's too late to find anything else to wear. So if we have enough, it's probably a good thing. But if you see to, it's a bad thing.
Hello, I'm Sam from BBC Learning English, and in this episode, we're going to look at the differences between see, watch, and look. All three are verbs, and all three involve using your eyes. See can have many non-literal meanings, but its basic meaning is to have the ability to use your eyes. I can't see anything. Or it can mean to notice something with your eyes. Did you see the full moon last night? It was huge. To look means to turn your eyes towards something so that you can see it. They said that if I look carefully at the painting, I can see a flower. And watch is to look at something for a period of time. Really looking carefully. Right now, you are watching this video and paying very close attention, I'm sure.
each, and every. Sometimes you can use either, but not always. In a group, each refers to individual things in turn. Every refers to all the things together. If I have time, I say bye to each of my colleagues. If I don't, I say bye to every colleague at the same time. If we have two things, we have to use each. If we have three or more, we can use each or every. I have a shoe on each foot. Lions have sharp claws on each or every paw. Each can be used as a pronoun, while every can't. Look at those cakes! I want a slice of each! Every object is together. Each object is on its own. Each is for two or more. Every is for three or more. Each can be a pronoun, and every can't.
Hi, I'm Saskia from BBC Learning English. Do you know how to use fine and finely? They can both be used as adverbs, but fine can also be used as an adjective. Let's look at some sentences. I broke my phone yesterday, but it's working fine now. Here, fine is an adverb of manner because it indicates doing something in a satisfactory manner.
I was tired, but
I feel fine now. Here, fine is an adjective, but notice how it sits after the verb and it means okay.
I ruined the recipe. I forgot to finely chop the onions.
In this sentence, finely is an adverb of degree and it describes how small something needs to be cut up. Right, I'm going to try that recipe again. I won't forget to finely chop the onions this time. Bye for now.
Hi, I'm Sam from BBC Learning English, and today we're going to look at the differences between to match, to fit, and to suit when talking about clothes. To match simply means that two things are the same or very similar, that they look good together. Your blue shirt matches your blue eyes. To fit means that something is the correct size. My glasses don't fit. This is a fact, not an opinion. So if you want to say that you think someone looks good in what they're wearing, to pay them a compliment, then we use the verb to suit. That dress really suits you. Yes, it looks and sounds the same as the noun a suit. The meaning and how we use it are different, but the spelling and pronunciation are the same. Not sweet, suit.
Let's look at the difference between on time and in time. They often mean the same, but sometimes they're different. On time means according to a schedule or a deadline. If I don't finish my work on time, my boss will be angry. My train is never on time. In time means not too late to be successful. So I missed my deadline, but I still got the presentation finished in time for the meeting. My train was late, but it still arrived in time for me to get to work early. Neither my presentation nor my train were on time, but they were in time for me to do what I needed to do. It's good to be on time. It's even more important to be in time. The difference is down to how flexible your schedule is, but be careful. Sometimes if you're not on time, you won't be in time either.
Hi, I'm Roy, and today I'm going to tell you the difference between continuously and continually. Both of these words are adverbs, and they can be confusing. They look similar, but they have different meanings. Continuously means that something doesn't stop or end. He spoke continuously for 15 minutes. That means he spoke for 15 minutes without stopping. Continually is a repeated action that happens over a period of time. So something starts and stops over some time. I continually tell my dog I love her. That means it's a repeated event. I say it many times. Well, that's all for today. But we here at BBC Learning English continually make new videos. So keep watching. Bye.
sensible and sensitive are often confused, but they are quite different. Sensible means that you have good judgment or are very practical. Sometimes the most sensible thing is to ignore what people say and look at the facts. Sensitive is related to feelings. If you're sensitive, it can mean that you think about how other people feel. Be sensitive to people's feelings and they might agree with you. It can also mean that your feelings are very easily upset. Don't be too sensitive about your idea being rejected. So being sensitive is all about feelings and kindness. Being sensible is about being practical and wise. Do you think it's sensible to be sensitive to other people? Are some people too sensitive to make sensible decisions? Tell us what you think.
Hi, I'm Roy, and today I'm going to tell you the difference between two words that are often confused, hear and listen. Hear is the verb we use to talk about the ability. It doesn't mean that we want to hear something. It's about sounds coming to our ears. I can hear the air conditioning. It doesn't mean that I want to hear it, but I can. The verb listen is often followed by the preposition to. We use this verb when we're paying attention or focusing on sounds. I hope you're listening to me. That means I hope you're paying attention. Compare these two sentences. I can hear some music somewhere. I am listening to some music. I'm listening to a song that I want to listen to. Anyway, I've got to go. I can hear my boss calling me.
Hi, I'm Georgina from BBC Learning English. Do you ever wonder about the difference between all, every, and whole? They all have similar meanings, but are used in different ways. All means the whole amount of something, 100%. It is often followed by uncountable nouns or plural nouns. He ate all the sugar. All children love sweets. Every has a similar meaning to all. It means each one without exception. I go to the gym every day. Whole means the complete amount of something and is followed by uncountable nouns or singular nouns. I ate the whole cake. The whole airport is closed. Bye for now.
Hi everyone, we're going to talk about three verbs with very similar meanings today: hire, rent, and let. I'm mainly going to explain how we use these verbs in British English, but I will also mention some American usage too. Both rent and hire mean to pay for the use of something. However, in British English, we normally use the verb rent to talk about a long-term arrangement. For example, you can rent a house, flat, or TV. When talking about a short-term arrangement, we normally use the verb hire. For example, you could hire a car, a bike, or a suit. The difference in American English is that the verb rent can be used for both long and short-term arrangements. The verb hire has a completely different meaning. It's used to mean to employ somebody. Finally, we have the verb let. You might hear this word in the phrase room to let, for example, which means that the room is available to rent. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Bye.
Hello, I'm Sam from BBC Learning English, and today we're going to look at the difference between all and everybody or everyone when talking about people. In both cases, we are talking about a group of people, and the meaning is simple. They both mean 100% of the group. But how we use them in a sentence is slightly different. Let's look at these examples. I invited some friends to a party this weekend. They all came. Everybody came. So in the first example, we have the subject plus all plus the main verb. It's not correct to say all came without using the subject they before all. But if you want to make the sentence shorter, you can use everybody or everyone as the subject of the sentence. So, everybody plus main verb. So I hope you all understand, and everybody will do the quiz now.
We're going to talk about the difference between last, for the last, and in the last when talking about time. I went to the doctor's twice last week, last month, last year. Last week, last month, and last year here are talking about the week, month, and year before this one. There is no connection to now, it is before now. And what do we say when we want to talk about the day before this one? We just say yesterday, right? And we say yesterday morning, yesterday afternoon, yesterday evening, but last night. I've had the flu for the last week, so I've come to work only once in the last week. In both cases, we are talking about the period of time from a week ago until now. With for the last week, I've had the flu every day. It's continuous over a week. Within the last week, I have come to work only once within that time. Can you think of something you did last week? And what's one thing you've done in the last week? And something else you've done for the last week?
Hi, I'm Georgina from BBC Learning English. Do you ever wonder about the difference between soon, early, and quickly? They all have similar meanings but are used in different ways. Soon is used when we talk about something happening in a short time from now. I'll see you soon, in about 5 minutes. The film is starting soon. Hurry up or we'll miss the start. Early is used when we talk about something happening before the expected time. I had to go to work early because I had a meeting. If you get up early, you can go for a run. Quickly is used when we talk about something happening rapidly or at a fast pace. We're late. We need to walk quickly. I'm so excited. He replied to my text very quickly. That reminds me, I have a meeting starting soon. I've got to go. Bye.
Hi everybody, I'm Sam, and in this lesson I'm going to talk about need. Do you know the difference between needn't and not need to? Look at these two sentences in the present. Is the meaning the same or different? You don't need to worry about the exam. You've studied lots. You needn't worry about the exam. You've studied lots. They're the same, right? Maybe needn't is a little bit more formal, but the meaning is that there is no necessity for you to worry. Now look at these two sentences in the past. He didn't need to worry about the exam. He had already passed the course. He needn't have worried about the exam. It was really easy. These are different. In the first sentence, he had already passed the course, so he knew he didn't need to worry. In the second sentence, he didn't know the exam was going to be easy, so he was worried, but he needn't have been.
When do we use could and was able to talk about past abilities? If it's a positive sentence, ask yourself if it's a general ability, which uses could, or a specific achievement, which usually uses was able to. I could run really fast when I was younger. I was able to win a medal. But we do use could for a specific event if we use verbs related to senses or thought processes. I could feel the wind in my face. I could remember my coach's advice. If the sentence is negative, it's much easier. We can use either. I couldn't do much at school the next day. I wasn't able to concentrate at all. Negative or positive? Specific or general? Are there any senses or thought processes? What could you do when you were younger? What were you able to achieve? What could you see or hear while you were doing it?
Hi everyone, welcome back to English in a Minute. Peep, peer, and glimpse are all verbs of sight that mean look at something, but are used in different situations. Let's look at some examples. My friend peeped at my test answers. This verb means to look at something quickly and secretively. I peered at the document trying to understand it. Peer means to look at something intently or carefully in detail. It can also be used in another way. I was peering at the clock in the distance. This example means that I had difficulty reading the clock. Maybe the clock was very small or I have bad eyesight. I glimpsed the sunlight through the trees. Glimpse means to see something for a short time or to only see part of something. We often use glimpse as a noun with the verb catch,
For example, I caught a glimpse of Phil as he left the office. Bye, everyone.
I'm Georgina from BBC Learning English. Do you ever wonder about the difference between whisper, murmur, and mumble? They are all used to describe different ways of speaking quietly. Whisper means to speak quietly, often on purpose, so that only someone very close can hear what you're saying. I don't want everyone to hear. I'll have to whisper. I've got a secret to tell you. I'll have to whisper it, though. Murmur means to speak quietly, often in a low, continuous voice, so it's hard to understand. I love you, she murmured in her sleep.
Do you want to go for a coffee?
I can't hear what you're saying. Stop murmuring. Mumble means to speak quietly, often in a low voice, making it difficult to understand. She's always mumbling and complaining very quietly, so I can't hear. It drives me mad.
I'm really sorry, I shouldn't have eaten the last biscuit.
That was a really mumbled apology. I could hardly hear it. Bye.
Hello everyone, Sam here, and in this lesson we're going to look at the difference between also, as well, and to. Their meanings are similar. We are adding something, but we use them slightly differently in a sentence. We use also with the verb in the middle of the sentence. He's really good at tennis, but he also plays football really well. Or you can use it at the beginning of the sentence to add emphasis. He's really good at tennis. Also, he plays football really well. As well and to go at the end of the sentence. He's really good at tennis and he plays football really well too. He's really good at tennis and he plays football really well as well. The only slight difference is that as well is less common in American English and more common in British English than to. So what about you? Are you only learning English or are you studying other languages as well?
Hi, I'm Roy, and today I'm going to tell you the difference between when and if. Firstly, you can use when or if with the present simple when it is a fact or a repeated action. If or when you put water in the freezer, it becomes ice. We use if for unknown or possible situations. If it rains today, I'll take my umbrella. We use when to say we are certain something's going to happen in the future. When I go home, I'll watch a film. Compare these two sentences. If I eat breakfast today, I'll have toast. I might not eat breakfast. When I eat breakfast today, I'll have toast. I will eat breakfast. Anyway, that's everything for today. I've got to go because I'm hungry. If I don't eat breakfast, I get grumpy. Bye!
Hi, I'm Georgina from BBC Learning English. Have you ever wondered about the difference between as if and as though? We use as if and as though to make comparisons about an imaginary situation or a possible situation that might be true. To make comparisons about an imaginary situation, we use the past tense for the verb following as if or as though. He acted as if he didn't hear anything, but he did. They feel as though they weren't appreciated, but they were. To make comparisons about a possible situation that might be true, we use the present tense for the verb following as if or as though. He speaks as if he knows a lot about cooking. He must love it. Let's ask her for directions. She looks as though she lives here. My stomach is rumbling as if I didn't have any breakfast, but I did. Bye.
Hi, I'm Phil, and I'm going to tell you the difference between beside and besides. That's one small letter, but it's quite a big difference. Beside, with no S, is a preposition, and we usually use it to talk about physical position. So you can say, put the chair beside the table, or come and sit beside me. It's like a more formal version of next to. Now, besides with an S is either a preposition or an adverb and is often used to add information. Besides knowing grammar well, you need to have a good vocabulary. You should do something else besides studying. Here, it's like as well as. As an adverb, it's often used to add a more important or stronger point. I'm going to practice now because I've got time, and besides, I need to. It's like a less formal version of moreover. So, besides remembering that beside is for physical position, remember that besides is for adding information.
Hi, I'm Georgina from BBC Learning English. Do you ever wonder about the differences between next, the next, and nearest? Next means immediately after this one and is often used with day, week, month, or year. I go on holiday next Tuesday. I'll start my diet next week. The next means the period of time starting from now. The next 2 weeks are very busy. It'll be cold for the next few days. Nearest means the closest to something or someone in distance. The nearest bus stop is over there. I think we should stay at Susie's. She lives the nearest to the airport. Right, I'm off to the nearest cafe to get a coffee. Bye.
Hi everyone, James here. We're going to take a look at some quick and easy ways to agree with other people's opinions. If someone says something positive that you agree with, you can say, so do I, or so am I.
I love sushi.
So do I.
I'm really tired today.
So am I. You can also say, me too. However, when somebody says something negative with the word not, for example, we use the word neither or neither. Neither do I, or neither am I.
I don't go to the cinema very often.
Neither do I.
I'm not very well at the moment.
Neither am I. We can also just say, me neither. So, to agree with something positive, you use the word so. But to agree with something negative, we use the word neither or neither. Thanks for joining us, everybody.